Hey, brothers and sisters, this is your most favorite brother from another mother, Brother Patrick, coming to you from the fabulous country of the Philippines. Brothers and sisters, praise God, praise God, praise God, through whom all blessings flow, brothers and sisters. Hallelujah. In all things, the Bible says, count it all joy. James chapter 1, count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations. Hallelujah. For the trying of the faith worketh patience. You know, brothers and sisters, I would just tell you for your prayers, Sister Micah, who did the zeal for us. Her husband just died a few days ago. The good news is he was a Christian. He was been looking for the rapture and looking for the rapture and waiting on the rapture. And praise God, he's with the Lord. Hallelujah. So I ask you for your prayers for Sister Micah. And like I said, though, when someone who's a Christian dies, praise God. You know, there's people that die every day that are not Christians, brothers and sisters. They said, when I started the ministry, I did a study on that, my first sermon. And at that time, that's the year 2000, 2001, there was 3 million people dying every year in the United States and 1 million claiming to be born-again Christians. So, at a minimum, 2 million people dying in the U.S. every year, lost and without hope in this world. So, praise God, when a brother or sister goes on, sometimes, you know, churches will have a celebration and call it a graduation ceremony. Hallelujah. And ask you guys also, as I'm just thinking about it, Brother Sid, he's had a little bit of a medical scare today, but praise God, I prayed for him and other people prayed for him, and praise God, they're going to send him home. He's just going back for some kind of stress test. So praise God for that. Brother Sid, the science kid, we did the video before. If you remember, he helped me start the Church of the Firstborn website originally. Was one of the people that helped us get it started. And Brother Sid had done the videos with me about the flat earth before. If you saw it, we were talking about, you know, the movement of whether the flat earth movement that was happening even in the Christian community on YouTube. Anyway, brothers and sisters, praise the living God. It is the resurrection day. You know, I always call every Sunday resurrection day. That's why I worship the Lord every day, but I try to make a straight away preaching video every Sunday for Sunday morning in the United States, Sunday night here, because the Lord rose from the dead on the first day of the week. Hallelujah. And the church has been meeting on the first day of the week ever since. We have a new testament, a new covenant. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. For we, the Bible says, we have a better covenant. Hallelujah. A better covenant in Christ Jesus. Praise God. Oh, what a friend we have in Jesus. Oh, what a friend we have indeed. Hallelujah. Yes, he is a friend. I am a friend of God. Praise God. You know, brothers and sisters, this is the Lord's been showing me so much stuff about end times. And that's what the masses who run to and fro on YouTube are looking for, end time stuff. But we have to grow in the Lord, brothers and sisters. And so the Lord gave me a message, a word for you, brothers and sisters. Hallelujah. The people that are serious Christians, trying to mature in the Lord and be, you know, discipled, who watch my channel. There's about 300 or 400 people who are really interested in being discipled that watch my videos. And the Lord gave me a word really for you guys, those who would watch this video that's not about rapture dreams or whatever. Okay, end times and all that. And it's this, brothers and sisters. And the Lord had talked to me years ago and told me something about this. And the Lord really wants me to share this with you. It's really going to bless your heart. A long time ago, the Lord had spoken to me and he said, I just want to walk with mankind in the cool of the day. Just like that. The Lord said, I just want to walk with mankind in the cool of the day. That's it. That's it. Now, when I make videos, and the focus I always go to, because a lot of people, you know, it's always about me, or, you know, people, it's always about, and I use the acronym JOY. If you want to have joy, you have to spell it properly. So it's spelled J-O-Y. Jesus first, others second, yourself last. Most people, they get that out of order, and that's where they run into trouble. And a lot of people, they put themselves first. Some people put their dog first. Some people put their husband first, or their children first, or their parents first, whatever. You know, we have to put Jesus first, then other strangers. You know, Jesus talked about, he said that, even the heathen or the pagans, you know, in some translations, the heathen, non-believers, you know, they are even nice to their own relatives. But what you do to a stranger, they're in the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew chapter 5, 6, and 7. The Lord says that, you know, what you do for a stranger instead of, you know, your own relatives, You know, for those who can't repay you, the least among us, other people that you don't know that you do things for, that is to be godlike. When any, you know, even, you know, wicked people help their own relatives, their own family. There's nothing special about that. It's the other person that you don't know that can't repay you, the Samaritan, like the story of the Good Samaritan, you know, someone that's even your, would be your natural enemy, you know, in this world. You know, the type of the Good Samaritan is kind of a racist issue between the Israelites, the Jews, and the Samaritans. It was kind of a racist conflict. So it would be like, you know, you say, oh, you know, you need to go help some Hispanic people if you're white, or black people if you're white, and white people if you're black, etc., that kind of a thing. You know, help someone that, you know, outside your comfort zone, outside your circle of friends, if you are in that situation, whatever. But what the Lord wanted me to talk to you about was kind of the different thing than that. And this part that the Lord wants to me to emphasize to, he's emphasizing to me and emphasize to you, is this. You know, it's the crux of all the things I talk about in my videos. There are people who watch my videos, and the majority of them are worried, you know, about not pleasing the Lord and living in sin and all that kind of stuff. And they're like, you know, not meeting the mark. I mean, the words in the Bible, really the definition of sin is missing the mark. You know, falling short is the way the King James says it. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. So it's like shooting an arrow at a target. You know, you missed the target. Is really, you know, the metaphor of in the Hebrew of explaining a sin. So we all do that. And so I've talked to you guys in the past, and, you know, not to be sin conscious, to be Christ conscious. You know, turn your eyes upon Jesus. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in His wonderful face. And the things of this world will grow strangely dim in the light of His glorious grace. You know, in the other song, you know, the cross before me, the world behind me, you know, no turning back, no turning back. I have decided to follow Jesus. That's what He told His disciples, and that's what He said to us. He who does not take up his cross daily and follow me is not worthy of me. That's in Luke. He uses the adds daily, you know. In Matthew, He says, who did not take up his cross and follow me is not worthy of me. He who puts his hand to the plow and looks back is not worthy of me. So that's what He said to people. Follow me. Hallelujah. And I'll make you fishers of men. I have decided. That's what it means to be a Christian, is a disciple of Jesus, a follower of Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back. Hallelujah. The Lord before me, the cross before me, the world behind me. The cross before me, the world behind me. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. Brothers and sisters, that's it. You know, then I'm going to take you to the next level. So we're not worried about, you know, when you get saved, you're supposed to repent. Turn from your bad ways. That's the negative part. To turn away from sin. Negative sanctification. To turn away from doing drugs or whatever you're doing. Practicing homosexuality. Practicing fornication. Pornography. Blah, 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 blah. Whatever. Sin. And then the positive sanctification is to follow Jesus. Drop what you're doing and follow Jesus. And that's where all these denominational, you know, people get it wrong. These once saved, always saved people. It's not about saying a sinner's prayer and then living like hell the rest of your life and go to heaven. Living for the devil and I'm following Jesus. No, it's to follow Jesus. Jesus said, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments. Now I want to qualify that. The New Testament commandments, to love each other as I have loved you, Jesus said, that the world may know you're my disciples. To love God with all your heart, all your mind, all your soul, and love your neighbor as yourself. Those, the New Testament stuff that the Lord gave us to do. And those things from the New Testament, like the Sermon on the Mount, etc. And I'm not going to debate anybody that wants to be a Judaizer and a lawkeeper. And that's what I'm getting to. This is a crux of all the things I've been teaching. And thank God this is a capstone as far as I know. Of course, the Lord always gives, the Bible says, line upon line, precept upon precept, here a little, there a little. So the Lord continually builds and increases our understanding and wisdom and when we're seeking out His wisdom by His Spirit and by His Word. And so here's the whole new thing that the Lord has given me, a whole new level of understanding. And it's just so simple, brothers and sisters. It's just so simple. There's one sister named Sister Christy from South Carolina who, when she wanted to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit, and, you know, I'd made videos and talked about lots of things, but she had picked up almost on this thing. She was almost on it when she talked about, you know, what was keeping her from receiving the baptism of the Holy Spirit. She said, it's not about being perfect. It's not about being perfect because you never be perfect, but it's about, you know, the grace of God and in Christ. And so, as I said, the one way of saying is the Lord just wants to walk with us in the cool of the day. Jesus told his disciples, I'm talking about getting beyond the basics here. You know, the as it says in Hebrews chapter 6, moving on beyond the, you know, the elementary things of the faith, you know, water baptism and salvation by grace through faith, all those things. You got all these people way down at the bottom of the mountain of God, way over there in the shallow end of the pool, still arguing about water baptism and all that, whether you can sprinkle somebody's head and all that. That's, of course, people need to be submerged in water. It's very clear in the Bible. That's what, that's just, I'm not going to go back there and debate with people on that. They can't even go be obedient, go get water baptized. How in the world are they going to the top of the mountain? You know, and I've been very patient and nice to people that ask me, do I need to be water baptized to go to heaven? No, but the Lord said, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments. So the question is, why are you trying to justify the fact that you're not been water baptized? I'm just curious. If you can't obey something as simple, I mean, you know, dunking, you know, getting dunked underwater, you know, by a minister of the gospel is nothing compared to being like martyred for the faith, being fed to lions, you know, the things that have happened to millions of people, and, you know, maybe going to be a missionary in a place where you're surrounded by, you know, there's ISIS 2 hours away from you, like me, you know, where you have Muslims that have been, they've been kidnapping Americans and Canadians and other Westerners, Germans, etc., and they beheaded like 10 people on the island that I'm on last year. The ISIS, you know, Muslims, the radical Muslim groups have kidnapped and beheaded about 10 Westerners just in the last year on the island that I'm on. I mean, and that's still nothing compared to people that were fed to the lion. So, you know, you can't go get water baptized. Don't talk to me about your walking with Jesus. Don't talk to me about, you know, going to be in, you know, going to the Middle East and being one of the two witnesses or 144,000 witnesses. When you can't do this elementary, this is 101 stuff. I'm not talking about 101 stuff. I'm talking about, you know, let's talk about, you know, graduate level studies, you know, master's degree from the master, okay? So, being in the master's degree program of the master, and this is it. Jesus was, and the Lord, by His Holy Spirit, was speaking into my heart. The Holy Spirit was speaking to me yesterday, and He said, you know, people have to get it this in your head. If you're really a disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ, and you're walking with the Lord wants to walk with us in the cool of the day, so you have to get past. And I've said it in another way in other videos earlier. In various ways, the Lord has given me the wisdom. It's like the temple. You know, people, most people, this is the same message, you know, the Lord had given me before. There are many people that get stuck at the brazen altar outside the temple. And those of you who don't know about the temple and the structure of it, well, you need to study the Bible and you need to be enough of a disciple to know what I'm talking about. If you're not enough of a disciple to know what I'm talking about, you're still in the shallow end of the pool. You need to get up to speed. You want to do mighty things with God. This is basic stuff, basics. So in the outer court of the temple, you know, you have these different courts of the Gentiles and then the men and the women's court anyway. So you go there where only Israelite men could go to the priest and they would offer animals and they would burn it on the brazen altar. That represents repentance. Okay, most people, and I made videos about this 2 or 3 times way back, talking about going into the Holy of Holies. This is another way of talking the same thing. So just another illustration that God gives us to show what I'm talking about. So most people are out there at the brazen altar. They can't get past repentance because they keep living in sin. They're sin conscious. A lot of you guys, it's not that you're big sinners, but you're sin conscious. You're focused on sin. You're focused on the don'ts and not on the do's. And what God wants you to focus on is not the don'ts, but the do's. And do follow Jesus. Do go into the Holy of Holies. Go past the brazen altar. Go past the, you know, read the Bible. Get some word in you every day. Go past that table of showbread. Jesus is the bread of life, and the word is our, give us this day our daily bread. A rhema, word from the Lord, a now word from the Lord, from the word. The Logos is the whole Bible. Jesus is the Logos, the whole word, and then a rhema is a now word, a word from the word, a quickened word in your spirit for the day, our daily bread. Get that. Then you have the Holy Spirit there, the represented by the, you know, the menorah. You have the light of the Spirit of God. Jesus said, I am the light of the world. That's why, you know, I don't want to go, that's why the Festival of Lights. Jesus talked about that at the Festival of Lights and, you know, the with the Hanukkah, that he stood right in front of that there and said, hey, I'm the light of the world. Hallelujah. And then you had the altar of incense. This is in the holy place, these things I'm talking about. Inside there, the altar of incense, of course, represents prayer throughout the Bible, like in the book of Revelation. We see where it's talking about the incense represents the prayers of the saints. So if you petition the Lord and worship the Lord and praise the Lord, then this is what I'm talking about. I'm making a short version of this. This is a short version of this. You go into the Holy of Holies, which is where the Lord is. Now, that's what it used to be. So you Judaizers, Jesus said in John chapter 4, when the Samaritan, which like I said, they're racist against each other, the Jews and the Samaritans. She's like, you know, here you are, a Jew, asking me for water. And they were fighting over where we're supposed to worship God, either in Samaria or in Jerusalem, which Jerusalem was the right place. And because Jesus said, you know, salvation comes by the Jews, the Israelites, not by the Samaritans. They're totally wrong. Anyway, Jesus said, God, in John chapter 4, God doesn't want you to worship Him in Samaria or at the Temple Mount. The time is and the now is coming. The time is coming and now is when God doesn't desire people to worship Him on the Temple Mount, in the temple. A lot of you guys want to go up there on the Temple Mount and worship God. God doesn't desire people to worship Him there or in Samaria. But it says, Jesus said, God is a spirit and He wishes those who will worship Him to worship Him in spirit and in truth. In spirit and in truth. Hallelujah. That's where the Holy Spirit comes in. All these denominational people trying to worship God in their flesh. When you go, and I've talked about this before, you can go to a church as an example. My grandmother was in the seniors choir at a Southern Baptist church. I went there not only to hear her and they had a Christmas thing and all this. I went there, the largest church where I'm from. It's a Southern Baptist church. They have adopted a lot of the songs from the Assemblies of God and all this. They try to adopt these anointed songs. But when they sang it, it was like a whole group of people that were deaf. It was like a whole group of deaf people trying to sing. It was as flat and as dull and as dead as you know, some cats out there fighting. That's what it sounded like. In the spirit, not in the natural, in the spirit. So a lot of times when you go to churches, they're like, oh, we'll let you sing. If you can sing good, can you sing good? And all that, like a concert, like a performance for man. That's the flesh. But it's not worshiping God in spirit and in truth. As a matter of fact, I can do a whole video on that. The denomination I originally came out of, the Baptist, Southern Baptist, Mission Baptist, Bible Baptist, they worship the Lord in truth, but not in spirit. They've got truth, but not spirit. There's a lot of charismatic people. That's the charismatic movement in the denomination. It's not Pentecostal people, but like there's a movement, a charismatic movement in Presbyterians and Lutherans and Catholics and all of them, they have like a special meeting for people that are charismatic. They have spirit, but no truth. That's how you got a clown like Todd Bentley, who was down there having that revival in Florida, and then he starts getting wacky saying, you know, the whole purpose of this revival is to introduce you to the angel called Emma. Not to the gospel of Jesus Christ, but to an angel named Emma. A female angel named Emma is who God wants you to know about through this revival. That's what Todd Bentley said. In between going and getting more tattoos, God told him to put more tattoos on him and earrings and all the things he said and did. It's because he had spirit but no truth. So you got to have the Spirit and the Word, brothers and sisters. Hallelujah. You know, and that's even, you know, explained in the tabernacle in the wilderness. I did a video about that before. Outside, around the tabernacle, they had these, you know, these posts with a silver base or a brass base and a silver top. And then there's two ropes coming off each one of these posts to hold them up. And I talked about the illustration that one rope is the Word and one is the Spirit. And then that's a whole other thing. But anyhow, so all these places where people fall into the pit, where the blind lead the blind into a pit. And brothers and sisters, that's what the Lord wants. That's all the Lord wants. He wants you to not be worried about your nakedness or trying to cover yourself with a fig leaf, because the Lord's already provided a covering for us like He did Adam and Eve. He already gave us a covering. The Lord wants us to come out of hiding from our sin. That's like, I talk to people every day, like, oh, I can't, you know, they do this like Adam did. But we have the blood of Jesus. See, it all started in the garden. And the Lord's taking us back. It ends in the garden, in the millennial reign of Christ. You know, in the eternity with Christ, it ends with us. What's the whole point? The restoration of man. That's the whole point of the Bible. You know, it's the story of his story, the story of Jesus Christ, and what he did with mankind, what God did with man. I mean, God is eternal. He's beyond the Bible. The Bible is part of God, but, you know, God didn't put in the Bible all the details of how he did the creation and all that. He just gives us an outline, what we need to know. That's part of God. But that's not all of God. It says, eyes have not seen or ears have heard the things that God has in store for us. But he has revealed them to us, by his Spirit, the Bible says. Not just in the Word. Eyes have not seen or ears have heard. If it was written in the Bible, then we could have heard it. And we could have seen it. There's all those things about what's going on in heaven. We don't know what all is going to be going on in heaven. You know, because it's not given to us in the Bible that God chose to, you know, the Word that God gave to give us. That's part of his revelation. God reveals things and we will have all this, you know, new revelation when we get to heaven. Hallelujah. Praise God. And then bits and pieces here, as Paul said, we look through a glass darkly. We look through a glass darkly. So, brothers and sisters, what the Lord wants from us is just that simple. The end goal of man is to be restored back to God, to bring glory to God. Okay? But what God wants is, what is it called when we go to heaven after the rapture? We have a supper, the marriage supper. I mean, what did Jesus say? You know, the Lord is just giving this to me now. What did Jesus say at the Last Supper? You know, how have I longed to have this meal with you? Jesus said he longed and looked forward to having that Last Supper, to break bread with his disciples. I mean, that's what it's all about. You know, you go beyond worrying about your sin. You know, these cardinal-minded, brain, short bus-riding people, they're like, oh, so we have a license. I'm not saying that you had no license to sin. I'm saying you got to get beyond that. Not that you can just go sin. Get out of your cardinal-mindedness. You're cardinal-minded, not spiritually-minded. Set your mind on things above, the Apostle Paul said. Not on the things of this world, because the things of this world will grow strangely dim in the light of his glorious grace. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. This is all spelled out in the Bible. Be heavenly minded. We're supposed to have the mind of Christ. But most people don't have the mind of Christ. They got the mind of this world. They're caught up in the things of this world. That's why they're so sin conscious. Get your mind off your money and your money off your mind. You know, get your focus on Jesus. Hallelujah. Then he wants to commune with us. That's what I'm trying to tell you, what the Lord just shared with me yesterday. You know, and Jesus told his disciples at the Last Supper. You know, he told them all those parable things, and, you know, you see me, then a little while you won't see me, and, you know, and all this. And Jesus said, you know the way. And then, you know, the disciples are like, what do you mean we know the way? And Jesus said, oh, you've been with me all, I think it's Thomas. He says, or Philip, you've been with me all this time, and you don't know what I mean? I'm the way. That's John chapter 14:6. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and life. No one comes to the Father except by me. So then when the Lord began to keep on speaking to them, they said, oh, now we understand. Now you're speaking to us plainly, but not in parables. And Jesus said, I won't call you my disciples anymore, but I will call you my friends as long as you do the things I say. So when you're walking in fellowship with the Lord and following Jesus and not living in sin, you'll be his friend and not his disciple. Do you understand? That's what God wants. He made Abraham a friend of God. Moses spoke to God and was a friend of God. God wants us to be like that, to be his friends. Well, it tells back in the Old Testament, Brother Gary and I, Bear049, we talk about this all the time. You know, and I don't think I've ever mentioned it in the video. My prayer since I started in the ministry, my main number one desire is to be a friend of God. You know, because it says in the Old Testament, he said, you know, God told Moses. He says, you know, I talked to the prophets in dark sentences and riddles. The New Testament, Jesus spoke in parables. And then Peter said, well, Lord, why do you keep talking to everybody in parables all the time? He said, because it's not meant for them to understand what I'm saying. Hearing, they don't hear, and seeing, they don't see, that otherwise they might be converted. So God speaks in a mystery and parables and metaphors to people, but his true people, either A, he gives you the interpretation of the tongues or the metaphor or the parable, or he speaks to you plainly, as Jesus spoke to his disciples plainly. And that's why, you know, the Lord had me, you know, because my ministry is really prophetic. And the hardest part of that is talking to pastors. Especially when I first started out. Now, of course, by the grace of God, I don't have any problem. But when I was new, I was a little fearful. The Lord would send me to a pastor of a church with a word from him, and I was afraid. And then I would tell them, or I would email them. That was a whole lot easier so I could make sure I got it right. I would email the pastor who already knew and email them and say, well, you know, the Lord has sent me to tell you this, blah, blah, blah. And then they wouldn't understand it. They would say, why are you speaking in a parable? Why are you speaking in like a poetic way to me? Just say plainly what it is the Lord wants me to know. And I'd pray about it. The Lord said, no, you give it to them just as I told you. Now, that's why they can't understand it, because they can't hear my voice. My sheep know my voice, and they answer not to another. That's why all these people, you know, like atheists are like, oh, I'm going to read the Bible and see if it's real or prove it's wrong. The Bible says that the Bible is spiritually discerned. So in other words, you try to be a smart aleck and you try to be a smarty pants and go try to, you know, disprove that speaking in tongues or disprove there's a millennial reign of Christ or disprove the rapture and all this kind of stuff. You know, God's not going to let you make a mockery out of His Word. Those atheists and all those kind of people that do that. You have to be, the Bible says God is a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6 is one great verse. It says, without faith, it's impossible to please God, and He is a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him. And God is not mocked. You cannot mock God or make fun of His Word. The Bible says God gives grace to the humble, but He resists the proud. So many people are prideful. They go along like, you know, in my natural mind, I can understand what the Bible's saying. No, no, no. You will understand in your natural mind once you understand it in your spirit. And that only comes through humility. Will God open your mind? Think about this. The Lord has given me a great example. Check this out. I would have never thought about this either in a million years. On the road to Emmaus, after the crucifixion, some of the disciples were walking there, and they ran into this dude. They didn't know who the dude was. And then they're talking about the crucifixion of Jesus. And everybody knew about it. And the guy's like, oh, what are you talking about? And they're like, you don't know? I mean, everybody's talking about it. This guy, you know, Jesus, the claims to be the Messiah, was crucified. And, you know, he said he was going to rise from the dead and all this. And then the guy said to them, oh, you know, you guys have... Of hard-headedness, hard to believe, stiff-necked people. Don't you know that how the Messiah was supposed to not come as a conquering king the first time? That's the second time. The first time he would be the suffering servant of God, and he would die, and they fulfilled the scriptures through doing these things. And so it says their heart burned within them, and then they invited him into the house to eat with them. He was going to go away, and they said, no, come home with us and eat, because it's getting late. And so this dude, who they didn't know who he was, they didn't recognize who he was, they went into the house and they sat down. And as soon as he blessed the food and broke bread, it says their eyes were open and they saw that it was the risen Lord Jesus Christ. And brothers and sisters, they've been walking with him for hours down the road talking about the gospel, talking about Jesus and fulfilling the Old Testament. And they had no idea it was Jesus. Why? But if their eyes had been opened spiritually, they would have known the very minute, hey, that's you, Lord Jesus. Even the women, Mary Magdalene and them, when they went to the grave early on the first day of the week, a.k.a. Sunday morning, that's why we have Sunday service, because Jesus rose on the first day of the week, early in the morning, that's why we have Easter sunrise and all that. Mary Magdalene and them, they went there to the grave to find Jesus, and then she didn't recognize Jesus either. It says she supposed he was the gardener, and she said to him, sir, where have you taken my Lord, and if just tell me and I can go get the body. And then Jesus spoke her name. And as soon as Jesus spoke her name, boom, her eyes were open and she knew it was Jesus. And she called him an Aramaic. They were speaking Aramaic, not Hebrew. Speaking Aramaic, right? The Bible's written in Greek, the New Testament, but they spoke Aramaic. She said to him, Rabboni, which is Rabbi in Aramaic. And it was Jesus. It was revealed to her at that time. Hallelujah. So praise God, brothers and sisters. And I guess that's really... You know, now that I'm given this message, that's the word from the Lord. He wants that our eyes would be open, that we might recognize Him, we might fellowship with Him. So, you know, God is everywhere. The Spirit of God is available everywhere, immediately, anywhere. God is omnipresent, always available to us 24 hours a day. And especially, you know, as Christians, we have that covenant. We have a relationship with Him. He's immediately available for us. The Lord wants to fellowship with you. He wants you to have your eyes open and your eyes not be darkened anymore, but be full of His light, that your ears would be full of understanding, that you can understand the things of God. Now, that's what my channel is, all the videos I make. There's lots of things in there that people have to have an ear to hear. And now, that's a real prophetic ministry, not these ones. You know, I had a friend who was a pastor. I helped him start a church. And he, you know, wanted to go around and hear all these alleged prophets. And I went with him. All they do is say, yeah, if you need a new house, get in the $100, write a $100 check, get in the $100 line. And I'm going to prophesy you're going to have a house, and or $200 line or whatever, the $100 line for a car and all this. Calling themselves prophets. That's not what prophets do. And it's not just like, we already got the Bible. It's not giving some, oh, well, God's going to do this in the millennial reign of Christ and all that. No. Being a prophet, even though we do can get words of wisdom and words of knowledge for people and prophecies for people, you know, like a word of knowledge. The Lord said you've been sick for the last 2 weeks, and then a word of wisdom. God wants you to I'm going to pray with you and you're going to be healed. Or, you know, it's because you're eating too much pork or whatever. You know, it's bad for you, or you need to stop smoking or whatever. The word of wisdom. What God wants you to do about the situation is an example. But the main thing is to tear down, like God told Jeremiah, to pluck up and root out and tear down everything that is man-made that's built upon the rock of Jesus Christ. The foundation that was laid by the Word of God, by the apostles in the New Testament, and the Torah and the law and all that in the Old Testament and the prophets. Everything that's built on that, that's made of sand, that's built from the imagination and the minds of man, is to be destroyed by the speaking of the Word and the power of His Spirit through God's prophetic people. That's what they call, in a denominational church, they say, hey, we're going to have a revival. You know, and a lot of churches bring in an evangelist, and they evangelize people. The church is for discipleship. The baseball field and a stadium and all that, and street and all those places in the world is a place for evangelism. Evangelists are evangelizing. Revival is by people to call the church back to their first love, to call the church to repentance. And that's what my ministry is all about, to prepare the bride to be rapture ready, brothers and sisters. And all those people, I'll say it again and again and again, as the Spirit of the Lord leads me. I can make a video telling about a rapture dream that I've had or something like that. Thousands of ADD people come out here and watch it. I make a video about being rapture ready, 300 or 400 people see it. But that's the video that people need to see. Not when, but if you're going. That's the thing. Are you rapture ready? Are you going into rapture? Are you going to heaven when you die? That's what counts. That's the thing about it. And I'll say this. Wisdom is knowing the right question. Wisdom is knowing the right questions to ask. That's the thing. Wisdom is knowing the right questions to ask, brothers and sisters, because there's lots of information, you know, especially with the internet, right? The information age, the information superhighway. There's tons of information, but you can't know it all. So the question is, what information do you need to know, and what information do you need to flush down the rabbit hole of your memory? And that's where people get caught up, majoring in the minors when you need to major in the majors and forget the minors a lot of times. And so, brothers and sisters, the message from this video is God has called you to walk with Him in the cool of the day, not to focus on sin. Get past the brazen altar. Get past, you know, get some word in you. Don't just keep milling around and say, oh, I'm going to eat some showbread. I'm going to eat some showbread. Eat the showbread. Offer your praise and worship at the incense altar. Be wallowing around there in the presence of the Holy Spirit. But then enter into the holy place. That's the time. I'll tell you what happens in the holy place, brothers and sisters. It's a time to be silent. That's the time when God speaks. God speaks to us and communes with us in the secret place. You got to get there, brothers and sisters. You got to get there. And it's by determination and faith and patience and humility. Put on that garment of humility. Don't let that's the problem with these Judaizers, see? Or someone says, oh, I fasted for a week. Our deeds are filthy rags in the eyes of God. If you're wearing a big bright necklace, a big bold, you know, a big bling bling that says, I fast 3 days a week, like the Pharisee guy fasting all the time, that the reflection off of that bling bling is going to blind you. That's why you have to have on the garment of humility, like in the text I'm talking about, where the Pharisee says, Lord, thank you, Lord, I'm not like this old tax collector here, the publican. Thank you, Lord, that I'm, you know, I fast 2 times a week and I tithe and all that. Then the tax collector just looked at the ground, hit himself in the chest and said, forgive me, Lord, I'm a sinner. Jesus said, that man was justified in the eyes of God. See what I'm saying? It's humility. And that's the whole problem with these Judaizers and sacred namers. They're self-righteous, just like the Pharisees. They're self-righteous, arrogant, and nobody's perfect, so they end up being hypocrites too. That's why we have to be humble. God gives grace to the humble, but he resists the proud. Humble yourself, the Bible says, in the mighty hand of God, and he will strengthen you. Hallelujah. God will give you the strength. Hallelujah. I want to pray for you right now. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father, we give you the praise, Lord. You deserve the glory and the honor. Lord, we lift our hands in worship as we bless your holy name. You deserve the glory and the honor. Lord, we lift our hands in worship as we bless your holy name. For you are great. You do miracles so great. There is no one else like you. There is no one else like you. Hallelujah, Lord God. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, in your presence, there is joy divine. Lord God, we bless you. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord, we praise you. We worship you, O mighty God. There is none like you. We worship you, O Prince of Peace. That is what I long to do, and I give you praise. For you are my righteousness. Yes, Lord. We bless you, Lord. Yes, Lord, we humble ourselves unto you. Yes, we confess our unfaithfulness toward you. Yes, Lord, forgive our sins. Yes, Lord, and heal our land. Hallelujah, Lord. Yes, Lord, revive your church once again. Yes, Lord, that revival may come to this land. Once again, yes, Lord. Hallelujah. We bless you, Father, in the name of Jesus. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah. Father, I ask you to bless your people right now, Lord God. Bless them, Lord God. Lord, let them grow in relationship with you, Lord. I speak right now a spirit of relationship. And I hear the Lord say a spirit of rejoicing. Rejoice. Rejoice. Yes, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Rejoice in the King. Hallelujah. Rejoice. Rejoice. Hallelujah. Rejoice in the King. Hallelujah, Lord. We bless you, Lord God. Father, bless your people with health, wealth, wisdom, peace, joy, and love. Pour out your power and love, Lord, in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name, amen. Hallelujah. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy, holy. Worthy, 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 I want to see you. Yes, Lord. Open the eyes of our hearts, Lord. Open the eyes of our hearts. We want to see you. We want to see you. To see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy, holy. Holy, 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 I want to see you. Hallelujah. I want to see you. Hallelujah, brothers and sisters, you have to worship the Lord. Hallelujah. Enter in to that holy place. Go past all that. You got to, you know, if you need to repent, repent. You know, and go through that and go on in to the Holy of Holies. Enter in behind the veil. For the Bible says the veil is the flesh of Jesus Christ. It was torn that we might enter in. Hallelujah. Yes, we enter in to the Holy of Holies. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord God. I hear angels singing praises. I see men from every nation bowing to you, oh my Lord. Hallelujah. and a symphony of praise arises. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, yes. Holy, holy, your God Almighty, who was and is to come. Hallelujah. All creation is crying holy to the Lamb who sits upon the throne. We thank you, Lord God, and we bless you in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. We praise you, Lord God. Yes, the Spirit of the Lord is just beginning to move in here. Hallelujah. That's how it is. The longer you worship the Lord, you know, the Bible says the Spirit of the Lord inhabits the praises of his people. So the more you begin to worship him, praise him. You know, it's as far as you want to go. When I worship the Lord, it's as far as I want to go. As much as you can stand of his presence. Hallelujah. As long as you can stay and tarry. The Lord invites us to tarry with him. Hallelujah. And spend time with him. Like in the garden, you know, he walks with me and he talks with me and he tells me I am his own and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. Hallelujah. I come to the garden alone, while the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ears, the sound of God discloses. And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. Hallelujah. That's it. Because, you know, when you think about that, the joy I share with the Lord, nobody else has known, because everybody has their own walk with the Lord. That's why when people say stuff like, you know, you say, God is no respecter of persons. He's not going to use you more than he's going to use me. You're talking about salvation, not election. God chose Jacob over Esau. You know, he chose Isaac over Ishmael. He chose Abraham over anybody else. He chooses the people whom he chooses. King David over all of his brothers. So God chooses whom he will in election. So praise God, God chose us to be born again Christians. Hallelujah. And then within that, the Lord could, you know, it says he divides the gifts of the Spirit among us as he wills. Hallelujah. So praise God. If the Lord's called you to, you know, to do words of wisdom, words of knowledge, whatever it is, praise God, gifts of healing, etc., whatever. Hallelujah. Praise God. I praise God he called me to preach, to proclaim his word. Hallelujah. Anything God gives us to do, praise God, says, you know, do it with all your heart. Hallelujah. Praise God. God bless you all, brothers and sisters. Like I say, 99% of the people I meet, they don't do their calling in Christ. Then they're talking about, oh, what day's a rapture? Oh, there was a super blood moon. What day's a rapture? You haven't run your race. You're still back there at the starting line. You know, I'm in the home stretch. Some of us, maybe 10% of us in the home stretch, most of you back there at the starting line, still rubbing your big old, you know, your beer belly from not exercising, not moving in the Lord. You know, you're getting slothful, becoming a sluggard, as the Bible says in the Old Testament. Being a sluggard, still back at the start line, looking for, you know, wanting to know when it's time to eat. God bless y'all, brothers and sisters. Yes, the Lord has been showing me all kinds of stuff about the end times. I'll make some videos about it. I'll make the ADD versions. I keep saying I'm going to do it. I didn't make an ADD version for the last rapture dream I had. It's on a video that I posted, but you know, it doesn't matter to me when the rapture is. It's just that all the people that I can influence to be rapture ready are rapture ready. That's my calling, you know. Now, all of our calling should be to be rapture ready and to make sure anyone that we can influence and evangelize to be rapture ready, that they're rapture ready. That's our calling, our high calling in Christ Jesus. And, of course, to bring glory to God, fellowship with him. That's the bottom line of this video. The Lord wants us to walk as friends with him in the cool of the day.